My microphone, there we go. We had an issue where our beautiful sound system was not getting picked up by Zoom for whatever reason, so that was what took a delay, and we kind of cobbled together a patch. So thank you for that patience, both for those of you online and those of you here in person. For those of us here in the sanctuary at only our second hybrid service, our second in-person anything since March 2020, 21 months ago, we have a few reminders and requests. We're taking our precautions for COVID very seriously, especially as cases are on the rise this December. We ask that everyone over the age of 2 keep their masks on at all times when you're in the sanctuary. If you do need to eat or drink or take a sip of water or just take a mask break, we ask that you either step outside or find a room that's unoccupied to do so and come on back. We do have the windows open for some airflow, so stay as bundled up as you like. At the very end of the service, we'll trace outside for Sunday night. You'll probably want your coats because we have a kind of white Christmas. And finally, as much as I hate to say it, we do need to refrain from communal singing indoors. It's my favorite part of Christmas, but we're going to get through it. During the hymns, you'll all be invited to hum quietly into your masks while we're inside. So we're looking to those of you on Zoom to be singing along with great enthusiasm from home to help the community's joyful energy. We won't hear you, but we'll know, so thank you. Once we get outside for Sunday night, singing will be highly encouraged. An accessibility note for those of you joining on Zoom. We're using the auto-transcription feature to offer live captions as subtitles throughout tonight's service. While they're not perfect and sometimes quite humorous, we hope they'll make the service more accessible. If you're on a computer and would prefer not to see the captions, you can go to the little menu at the bottom of Zoom that says, and click the button that says Live Transcript, click the little upward-facing arrow, and select Hide Subtitle. If you missed something that was said throughout the service, you can also go to that menu and click Read Full Transcript. If you are new to Theodore Parker Church or you're visiting today, welcome. We would love to stay in touch. Those joining online are invited to fill out a connection card, which is a website, not a card. It'll give you an opportunity to do things like sign up for our weekly updates, let us know if you'd like us to be in touch with you, and let us know how we can best welcome you. A link to the connection card will be in the chat, as well as our contact info. If you're here in person, please come find me or any of the ushers at the end of the service to give us your contact info, because we'd love to be in touch. Our weekly services are Sunday at 10:30 a.m. We'll always be accessible by Zoom, and sometimes we'll have in-person options when COVID allows. Tonight, as always, we invite all of you to bring all of your perspectives, your beliefs, and your doubts, and all that is unique and wondrous about you. In the spirit of love, you are welcome here. People of all sexual orientations and gender identities, people of all economic statuses and professions, of all physical and mental abilities, people of all races, all creeds, all cultures, we welcome you. In that spirit of welcome now, let us enter this Christmas service as the choir comes on up to lead us in O Come All Ye Faithful. This is a 17th century hymn composed by John Francis Wade. I invite you, if you're here in person, to rise in body or spirit if you'd like, as we welcome each other in with O Come All Ye Faithful. The lyrics will be up on the screen. Thank you.
including temple walls in our bell tower, burning our bell. Invite Michael to join us for the welcome words if you're able to. Is that easy enough? Everything's a little complicated.
Welcome to this time of gathering when the year starts its turn from dark to light.
Welcome to this time of gathering as the turning of our hearts, the hope of enduring love is found in the message of the stars.
Welcome to this time of gathering when our yearning for an ever new beginning finds hope in the light of this community of faith. We are so glad to be together this evening, on the eve of Christmas, at the end of another very hard year. As Unitarian Universalists, the love that is within the Christmas message far outshines the need to determine fact from myth.
Does it matter that the story Christmas may not be entirely true? Not really. Being called to love as best we can without condition. Being asked to see and feel the birth of possibility anew. This is all to acknowledge the good news of this coming Christmas day. And really, every day.
Our opening hymn calls us all in hope to welcome Emmanuel, a sacredness that is within us as love, as truth, as light, as hope. Breathe with us as our choir calls us to worship, and let this song bring us into the Christmas spirit.
Thank you.
In a moment, we will light our flaming chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalism, and our Advent wreath, all five candles, as we reach Christmas. We invite Cecilia Bennett and John Lambert to share these words from Reverend Gretchen Haley just as soon as we spotlight them. Oh, they're out. Perfect. Please bring us into worship with these words from Gretchen Haley.
Tonight, we celebrate the relentless presence of love.
We cannot hear John. Is there anything you need to do about that? John, one moment, please. Okay, should I put him? You can hear him on Zoom. Okay. Great. John, you go ahead. You're going to read it for the Zoom people, and I'll read it for the folks in the sanctuary. Please, go ahead.
Okay, tonight we celebrate the relentless presence of love. Love, unconditional and perfect. Love born in the world again and again. Love ready to heal and forgive and unite across all differences and divides. Love born in each of us and offering itself to all. Love that will not give up, love that cannot stop making room for you.
They seem to have frozen. Oh, there we go.
Hey,
good.
Here in this ancient story,
these words from Reverend Gretchen Haley. Tonight we celebrate the relentless presence of love, love unconditional and perfect, love born in the world again and again, love ready to heal and forgive and unite across all differences and divides, love born in each of us and offering itself to all, love that will not give up, love that cannot stop making room for you. Here in this ancient story, told and retold across centuries and cultures, a tale of people seeking shelter from the cold after a long journey. People met by kindness in the silent night. Whoever you are, whatever the state of your heart, weary, wild, filled with wonder, the call to rejoice rings out for all to be held in this hope that love is not done with its work on this life, in this world, that love newborn is just getting started. So let us kindle once again this light of hope and celebrate Christmas once more. Come, let us worship together.
Next. sing. Still through the cloven skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lowly plains they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its babble sounds the blessed angels sing. But with the woes of war and strife the world has suffered long, beneath the angel's strain have rolled 2,000 years of wrong. And we who fight the wars hear not the love song which they bring. Oh, hush the noise of battle strife and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on by prophet bards untold, when with the ever-circling years comes round the age of gold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world give back the song which now the angels sing.
Thank you, Michael. And now invite up Sam Roller and Eli Feldman, two of our young adults, to read a passage from the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 1 through 14.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child.
While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night.
Then an angel of God stood before them, and the glory of God shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Fear not, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger."
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among all people."
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sam and Eli. And thank you, everyone, for going through us through the complicated nature of our tech adjustments this evening. I hope the folks on Zoom can hear me now. Please let me know if not. So we have a tradition here at Theodore Parker Church of taking time in this Christmas Eve service to name and celebrate the new life that has arrived among us in the past year. It's become one of my personally favorite community rituals. On this night, when people all around the world are celebrating the birth of one particular child through sacred song and story, in this community, we take the time to remember that each child is holy. Every birth is sacred. Let us take in that alongside all of the loss, struggle, and heartache of the past year, new life has also arrived. Each arrival holy and very much worth honoring on this night. We name and celebrate tonight the arrival of at least 12 new lives among us in this community. First, I will read the names that members of our community have shared with us in advance, and then I will invite all of you to share any additional names that were not already said. If you are here in person, at that point, you can get up and stand up in your seat and say the name. And if you are on Zoom, please write the name in the chat and I will repeat it here. But first, I will share the names that we already have. Adiella May Barker. Declan Shea Kearney. Olivia Ella Kenyon. Sloan May Laser. James Bruce Palmer. Ava Kate Rose Morgan. Grace Violetta Ritchie Ludwin. Mackenzie Graham Ritchie. Emmy Rockers. Sawyer Rockers. Walden Rose. Isabella Joy Spahn. Those of you with us here tonight have any additional names, please share them now.
Ramsey Benjamin Ramirez.
I'll check Zoom. Camille J. Martin. Theodore Chung. Isabella Testa. Thank you so much for sharing the joy of celebrating this new life on this sacred night.
In honor of that spirit of new life born, we sing In the Bleak Midwinter, celebrating the birth of love in our world.
Stood hard as iron, water the blood.
As the year winds down to its close, we think too of those whom we have loved and lost over this past year. So many. We share aloud the names that have been on people's hearts, as before, first those that folks submitted, and then we invite you to say their names aloud here in this sanctuary or put them in the chat for us to share. As we share their names, we bring their presence and their blessings into our midst. Tonight we remember Louise Marie Dietz, Laura Dowd, Nancy Geiger, Wendy Kay, Claire McLaughlin, David Berkeley Morgan, Sharelle Shaw, Terry Sword II, Lynn Throckmorton, Marilyn Young, and Penelope Clay. If you're holding another name in your heart, please share it now. George Mraz.
Elizabeth Davis.
Elizabeth Davis.
David Park.
David Park. Josh Harris, John Spolin, Richard Pereira, Ann Mita. For these and all we have lost, we give thanks to have had the opportunity to love them. May their memories be a blessing.
Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. From now on, our troubles will be miles away. Here we are as gather near to us once more. Through the years, we all will be together. If the fates allow. Until then, we'll have to muddle through somehow.
I invite you to join me now in a time of meditation, first in words, then in shared silence, and then in melody. Our words of meditation were written this year from the Reverend Teresa Nina Soto. It doesn't seem like much, one emperor, one mandate, one census, two young people traveling. And a young woman pregnant and feeling every bump on the road, every vertebra of the laden donkey. And arriving to their destination late in the purple night, lit by one bright star and so many cold shoulders. No, they said, no room here. Not good news for someone so near. And what about the backache and the contractions near to giving birth? And sometimes that moment is exalted as the advent arrival of the liberator. But the truth is that the dullness of heart, flatness of courage is the same as the no, the same as cold shoulders, rolling eyes, and doors blithely thrown shut. No angel, no astrologer, no star, and no sheep can convince a heart closed to the natural yes
of people around us, neighbor, kin, and about to be friend. What can we liberate if we cannot see the journey as an example of our own? Throw open the door. Make ready the space. Love as though there is no other medicine. What if you are not a righteous innkeeper, but instead the manger, the stable, a haven of rest? Let us meet together and share silence.
It is our practice at Theodore Parker Church to split the offering on Christmas Eve with the cause of community that is close to our hearts. This evening, we'll be sharing our offering with the Boston Immigration Justice Accompaniment Network, known as Beyond. Beyond is a network of faith communities, individuals, and other activist groups working to reduce the escalating harm of our immigration system. They work closely with immigration justice and abolitionist organizations to support those impacted by our racist immigration system. Beyond provides accompaniment, which can include support in court or at ICE check-ins, legal referrals, fundraising for bond or legal fees, letters of support from the community, rides from families to visit loved ones in detention, and logistical assistance with paperwork or bond payments. They also help with housing, transportation, and other immediate needs of people released on bond who have no other resources in the community. One of Beyond's core values and refrains that they so often say gets right to the heart of our Christmas message this year. We fight for one another as family because we are. In that spirit, we invite you to give as generously as you are able to support both Theodore Parker Church and the Boston Immigration Justice Accompaniment Network. Links to donate online will be in the chat, or you can send in a check to the church by mail. Please note, either online or on your check, that this is for the Christmas Eve offering, so we know to split it with Beyond. Ushers will be coming around in the sanctuary as well to collect an offering as Yukiko plays George Frideric Handel's Sarabande from his suite in D minor. Friends, thank you for your gifts.
Beautiful. Thank you. Keep going. I've been afraid a lot, especially since about March 2020. Probably not alone in that. Sometimes it's an acute and overwhelming fear. Sometimes just a gnawing concern about the state of the world, just living with uncertainty. Perhaps it's because of this emotional backdrop that one particular phrase has been jumping out at me as I reread the Christian scriptures account of Jesus' birth. The phrase, fear not. In the book of Luke, it's written that an angel appears to young Mary, and she's confused and concerned by its greeting. Fear not, the angel said. You have found favor with God, and you will bear a child who will be called the Son of God. After a little more conversation, and surely knowing the scandal that could come from being pregnant outside of marriage, Mary chooses to say yes, saying, "Here I am. Let it be as you have said." Joseph, too, is concerned, according to the book of Matthew, and plans to break off the engagement quietly. But an angel appears to him in a dream and says, "Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because all this has happened as a part of God's plan." When Joseph awoke, he did choose to wed Mary. And we heard it earlier in our reading from later on in the book of Luke. Angels appear out of nowhere to unsuspecting shepherds, keeping watch over their flocks by night. They are terrified, but the angels assure them, "Fear not, for I bring you tidings of great joy." Now, it's worth saying here that fear is a pretty reasonable response on the shepherds' parts. Lest you be picturing adorable cherubs, No, the Bible describes angels as more like these disturbing human-animal hybrids, things I would be alarmed to see appearing out of nowhere in the middle of the night. But these beings reassure the frightened shepherds, saying, "Don't be afraid, we're coming with good news." I could go on giving examples not just from Jesus' story, but from throughout the Christian and Jewish scriptures. God, or an angelic being, comes to humans and says some variation of, "Fear not, you are beloved. There is a plan, and this will work out. God is with you." Feeling reassured, the humans take the courageous action that is theirs to take. Like many of us here, those of us who tend to find ourselves at home in UU congregations, I don't know that I believe in a divine being that intervenes in human affairs or that has some great plan for us. Some days I wish I did. It's just not my theology, though. It makes me wonder, what might a Unitarian Universalist theology of reassurance, of fear not, look like? What does that reassurance in the face of fear call us to do? In this fearful time, I found some direction and insight from a less traditional source, a 1946 film we may have heard of called It's a Wonderful Life. Fair warning, there are spoilers ahead, but you have had 75 years to watch this classic Christmas film. It's on TV all the time, it's on streaming. This might be your Christmas activity if you haven't seen it. There is an angel in It's a Wonderful Life, Clarence Oddbody, who is sent to Earth to intervene in the life of one George Bailey. After living a life in service of others, passing up many of his own dreams to take care of his neighbors and his family. A financial disaster has befallen George's family business. In a spell of hopelessness, George is convinced his family and his town would be better off without him. He's about to throw himself off a bridge to end it all, and then at least his family would get the life insurance money. In response, the angel Clarence gives him a visit to an alternate reality in which George never lived, and how much worse off it was without his presence. This, in and of itself, is a moving illustration of the inherent worth and dignity of every person, the positive difference that each of us make in this world, whether we recognize it or not. Strange, isn't it? The angel says. Each man's life touches so many other lives. When he isn't around, he leaves an awful hole, doesn't he? But what struck me most this year was the end of the film. When George decides to live after all, he returns home to face the music and deal with the consequences of the financial ruin that is sure to befall his family and could land him in jail. It's not the angel who saves the day. It's George's wife, Mary, a different Mary. When George is in distress, Mary picks up the phone and calls a friend, saying that George is in trouble and needs their help. Once George returns home, neighbor after neighbor comes through the door with fistfuls of cash, offering whatever they could to help save off his business's financial disaster, whether it's a few crumpled dollars a neighbor had stashed away, or a huge sum wired from a successful businessman. Every contribution is given with a smile and received with great emotion. And while the money was absolutely necessary to help stave off disaster, the reminder of friendship and community was what was necessary to stave off despair. Each person showing up at George and Mary Bailey's home to help is the embodiment of fear not. You are beloved. We'll get through this together. We are with you. This is exactly the kind of reassurance that the Boston Immigration Justice Accompaniment Network offers, and why it's so fitting that we split our offering tonight with Beyond. Inside of a broken, unjust immigration system, they show up for those most at risk. They honor people's dignity and choice in a system that denies dignity and choice. They show up essentially with fistfuls of cash to bail out those held in immigration jail, saying, "Fear not, you are beloved. We'll get through this together. We are with you." They fight for one another as family because we are. This is fear not, for we are with you, not as an abstract concept, but as accompaniment, as companionship, this community. I think, too, of the work that is being done throughout Massachusetts to help resettle refugees from Afghanistan. After the Taliban took control of Afghanistan this summer, thousands of individuals and families fled for their lives. Many have been starting new lives here in Massachusetts with very little. Enter Catholic Charities of Boston and Combined Jewish Philanthropies, who have joined forces to help support and welcome more than 100 Afghan refugees who are arriving in our state.
religious communities and individuals, including right here in West Roxbury, are all pitching in to help offer these refugees help as they start over. Communities are organizing to provide financial resources for things like rent and food, forming teams to sponsor individual families and just show up to help them navigate the resettlement process, and donating material goods and gift cards. A rabbi in Brookline wrote recently about her experience picking up their refugee family from Logan Airport and driving the family of five in her car to their new home in Brookline. There, an apartment was waiting, ready with furniture, rugs, food and clothing, picture books, stuffed animals, and some basic items that they could use as they start to settle in. I got choked up when I read her account of that day, imagining the three children, ages 7, 5, and 2, hugging their stuffed animals that strangers had lovingly set up in their new homes. Fear not, for we are with you indeed. As we sang it, Christ a home stranger, so the Gospels say. Here's one more real-life story for you. Not so long ago and not so far away, there was a church in Texas called St. George's, different George, that had begun to prepare for Christmas. They wanted to do something really special for Christmas Eve. So after a lot of thinking, a lot of talking, and a lot of committee meetings, because it was a church, they finally decided to build a life-sized stable on the church's front lawn and act out the birth of Jesus of Nazareth. In other words, the church was going to have a live nativity. Even if some of them were nervous about all of the elements involved, the congregation grew more and more excited as Christmas Eve drew near. Even the humbugs joined in the fun, and everyone worked long and hard to make the costumes and the decorations. At long last, after over a month of building and painting, sewing and rehearsing, Christmas Eve finally came. The manger and stable were finished. The actors had memorized their lines, more or less. The costumes had been washed and pressed and properly fussed over. It was going to be perfect. It was going to be the most authentic Christmas Eve celebration ever. But then the cold snap came. Though they had all worked so hard, and even though the whole community was looking forward so much to this live nativity, Austin, Texas is not a city used to extreme cold. Some of their members didn't even own winter coats. They couldn't ask their members to stand outside in the freezing cold just for a play. So after talking with the actors and the minister, they sadly decided to cancel the live nativity. And then it occurred to them, if asking people from their church to spend an hour outside in freezing temperatures on Christmas Eve felt unreasonable, there was no way they could let anyone spend the night outside. And so as light snow began to fall and night began to deepen, Christmas Eve found the minister and several members of the church journeying through downtown Austin, looking for anyone in need of a place to spend the night. They walked the city blocks for hours, surprised by how empty they were. Finally, just as the group from the church was about to give up, they came across three people desperate to come in out of the cold. A young man, his even younger wife, and their newborn baby. As they listened to the family story, the miracle that would come to define St. George's Church and lead them into a new era of ministry unfolded. The family had recently fled to Texas from South America looking for a better life. She had just had the baby, and there hadn't been any room left for them at the shelter. They could hardly believe it, but St. George's had just welcomed a modern-day Joseph, Mary, and baby Jesus to spend the night in their church that Christmas Eve. And that, more or less, is the story of the 1989 Christmas miracle at St. George's Church. Through housing a couple and their brand new baby, they came to see Christmas through the eyes of the Holy Family. Wanting everyone in need to have a warm bed, they opened up the doors of their church after Christmas and fed and housed 75 people a night through that winter's unusual cold snap. Word quickly spread to other congregations in the area, and together they began hosting the first ever freezing night shelters in Austin churches. The spirit of love and generosity had been born anew in their congregation, a spirit that inspired them to reach outside their comfort zones and their carefully planned holiday celebration to see how they were being called to live a deeper meaning of Christmas. A rare cold snap had caused this congregation to empty themselves of what they wanted Christmas to be, which made room in their hearts so that they could make Christmas what one holy family desperately needed it to be. Fear not, for we are with you. This is my kind of theology, and perhaps one that we could say is a Unitarian Universalist theology. It says, the divine, if it's anywhere, is in each of us, and in how we show up for each other. That's how we create a heaven on earth. In my first 5 months here at Theodore Parker Church, I can reflect back to you that this is something you're already very good at doing. I have heard it in the stories of how being a part of this community, even through Zoom, sometimes only ever through Zoom, has felt like a lifeline for many of you through the isolation of the pandemic. I've seen it in the way that you care for one another in times of grief or injury or illness. One congregant told me that the way that you reached out in a time where they were sick was so overwhelming and so powerful. It was one of their most spiritual experiences. It was a true demonstration of, we are with you. We'll get through this together. You are beloved. So, what is the call that you need to hear this Christmas in the echoes of the angels' fear nots? In a fearful time such as this, what is the courageous act of showing up for one another that is yours to do, that is ours to do? What is the reassurance of support that you need to hear, or that you are called to create? Beloveds, look around. I mean, look around this room or around your Zoom squares. Could these be your angels? We close with a refrain from Reverend Teresa Iman Soto. Throw open the door. Make ready the space. Love as if there was no other medicine. What if you are not a righteous innkeeper, but instead the manger, the stable, or the haven of rest? So may we die. Welcome Ruth back up as our worship associate to come join me to share in one more reading. This is from the Reverend Victoria Stafford.
now is the moment of magic. When people beaten down and broken, with nothing left but misery and candles and their own clear voices, kindle tiny lights and whisper secret music. And here's a blessing. The dark universe suddenly illuminated by the lights of the menorah, suddenly ablaze with the lights of the kinara, and the whole world is glad and loud with winter singing. Now is the moment of magic. When an eastern star beckons the ignorant toward an unknown goal, and here's a blessing. They find nothing in the end but an ordinary baby, born at midnight, born in poverty. And the baby's cry, like bells ringing, makes people wonder as they wander through their lands what human love might, what human look like, might sound like, Samuel likely, feel like. Now, the moment, magic. And here's us. We already possess all of the gifts that we need. We've already received our presents. Ears to hear music, eyes to behold lights, hands to build true peace on earth, and to hold each other tight in love. Now is the moment of magic. We come to the candlelighting ceremony, which has been a tradition in New England Unitarian and Universalist congregations for more than 100 years. Here's some good UU theology. The magic is that the light all comes from one source. You don't light your own candle, the light is passed to you by someone else. And once you get it, pass it on. We will take the light from our chalice, which actually, Ruth, could you do that for us? Yeah. From this light from the chalice, we will pass it to the congregation in a moment, hand to hand. Those of you on Zoom, if you have a candle at home, please go ahead now and be the first to light yours. We'll have you up here on gallery view in the sanctuary in a moment, so that everyone can see your lights. So if you'll hold it up. Beautiful. You might just want to have just straight up gallery view. Yeah. So those of us in person, when the flame comes to you, please take your unlit candle to the flame so that we can be as safe with wax as possible. I ask any children present to keep an eye on the grown-ups and make sure that they're being safe and doing it carefully. We'll pass the light through the sanctuary as the choir sings Silent Night. And when all of the candles are lit, we'll pause, look around, raise our lights, take in our collective brightness. With the rhythm of the glow, we'll take that hush and mystery out into the street. We share this light as a reminder that what we do here matters, that who we are matters, and that the light that is kindled within each of us needs to be brought out into the world with our care and love. After we've taken in our collective light, we'll go on to humming Silent Night. Those here in person will file outside as you're able, and Rose will have us on video for that as well. So you might want to have your coats on before your candles lit, although I think you all already do because it's getting cold in here. Once we're all outside, Michael will lead us all in singing verse one of Silent Night, and we can really sing together outside. So the moment of magic. To pass our flame, I invite forward those who have kept the flame going in this congregation for years, and those who bring their new lights to us tonight. So I'm going to ask you to come forward if any of you who have been here in the congregation for more than, I don't know, 20 years,
or if it's less than 2 years that you've been here. Your lights, both old and new, are so necessary. So please come on forward if either of those are you, and take this light, and we'll start to pass it around. When we go outside, you're welcome to carefully bring your lit candles as we leave from the back, or extinguish them in the little cups of sand that are throughout the sanctuary. Now, joyfully, reverently, carefully, we share in silent night.
Thank you. Merry Christmas. Thank you so much. It was beautiful.
Yeah, it was gorgeous. Thanks so much.
Thank Wonderful. You so much. It was beautiful.
Merry, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Rose, I'm so sorry I didn't tell you about my...
Should we go out?
I'm clicking leave, but it's not leaving.
Wow, that was beautiful.